Hey, YouTube family. Okay, I'm going to go over a little bit of an update and then just some more information on this Maurice Taylor Sr. who decapitated two of his children, allegedly. Today was his arraignment, and it was just 12/21/2020. And apparently he told the judge that he was not guilty. It says right there, Taylor was said to have refused the attorney and told the judge he was not guilty. I kind of found that interesting because he also said that he wasn't guilty, apparently, the day that they were taking him away in this gurney. And this has always bothered me too. It says personal trainer dad, 34, accused of beheading his two children at their LA family home. Well, it's not really LA, it was Lancaster, but is seen being wheeled away, handcuffed to a gurney moments after the attack. And what bothers me and what I don't understand about this is the fact that they don't really tell us exactly what, you know, medical attention was needed for him to require a gurney. They said that one of the adults in one article that I read was like was injured and the other wasn't, right? Like that's what they said. I don't know injured how or what, in what way. I don't know if he just had shortness of breath. He's a personal trainer by profession, so I can't imagine that he's in bad health in any way. Just realistically, like, you know, thinking about the condition that he would be in. So I'm just really confused as to why he was the one in the gurney. The only other adult there, as we know, was his wife, Natalie. It says an adult female thought to be the victim's mother, which was his wife, and two other children were also present in the home at the time. They appeared to be unharmed and were being questioned by officers. Now, thank God the other two children were unharmed, but I can't get over the fact that she was unharmed, because like I said in the last video, there's no way that you're going to kill my child or torture my other children, lock them in their room or just have them go in their room and refuse to feed them for 5 days. 5 days. This is a picture of Natalie, the mom. And then on the left is her daughter, their only daughter, one of the children that was killed and beheaded that night or that day. We don't even know any really details about exactly what time this happened or why this happened or what happened. But I don't know, something about the mom's eyes that I've never liked. That's just my opinion. But she was unharmed. I just want you to think about that. She was in the house. She wasn't, you know, they didn't have to, you know, go through any barricade to get her. They didn't have to break down any walls. She was just in the house unharmed with two of her children dead and two of her children basically suffering from dehydration and starting to starve because they had been unfed for days. Meanwhile, she's in the house unharmed. I don't understand that. What I don't understand is how she wasn't arrested, but I'm gonna get into that more as I keep getting into this case and keep bringing you updates. So I want to go over what people that are close to them or that know them have to say about Maurice and what people have to say about his wife, Natalie, right? So we've got, you know, in this little clip, it says, think of the nicest person that you know, then multiply that by 5, Kern said of Taylor. Now, just so that, you know, if people aren't aware, Kern is Howard Kern. He is an attorney and a writer who has been a client of Maurice's for, I believe it was like 7 years. So he's known him for a considerable amount of time, right? He's the one that actually called in the firefighters to do the check because he said he's so reliable. And as you go to the bottom, it says that he's so reliable, so responsive. And that was said by another client, by even someone else. So he has multiple clients that, you know, even after this horrible, horrible occurrence, are really praising the man that he was, the man that they know. I mean, think of the nicest person that you know, then multiply that by five. And then everyone so reliable, so responsive. So anyways, just keep that in mind. And we're going to go on to another report. This is going to be involving Natalie. What do they have to say about her? Well, says that they believe that Taylor had been living under a tremendous amount of pressure and had a troublesome marriage. His wife reportedly made calls to him at work, yelling at him. It was embarrassing. You could hear her yelling at him. He'd be very apologetic and she'd be yelling at him. What does that tell you? Because it tells me that there is an aggressive member of this relationship and there's a patient person in the relationship. This isn't the only witness or friend or client that said this either about her calling him and yelling and screaming at him. But let me just go on to what another client said. Another client said that he was called him mellow and reliable. So these are the types of things that people were saying about him, right? I'll get back to that in a little bit. Next, I want to go over actually the GoFundMe, right? Because there's something in here that doesn't sit right with me either. I'm not saying anything negative about the, you know, the grandmother or the lady that's organizing this GoFundMe. I don't have anything against the fact that they, you know, have a GoFundMe. These children need, I'm sure, as much help and assistance as the two remaining. These actually, the children in this picture are the two that are now deceased. But there's another two children that are 8 and 9 years old that are recovering from what they had to go through. I just want to scroll down to the end, right? And this is what bothers me about this. Mind you, I've been checking ever since I heard about the story to make sure that the mother is not in custody. She is not in custody. The mother is not charged with anything. So keep that in mind. And it says right here at the very like bottom, it says, Miss Deb, who is the grandmother, the mother's mother, Miss Deb and her family will be fighting for her other two grandchildren to get them out of foster care and bring them home. Like, I'm like, why would they be in foster care? If they didn't arrest the mother because they felt like she was innocent, why wouldn't they still be with their mother? I also don't understand why they didn't go to a family member because, I mean, children never usually are put in foster care unless it's a last resort. When children are, you know, found and or taken from parents, or they usually try to find the closest available family member to take them, be it a grandparent, aunt, uncle, cousin, you know, anyone related to them, so that the children are not going to have to go through the trauma of foster care. They have went through the most traumatic experience I think anyone in this world could ever imagine having to go through, witnessing what they witnessed happen. Or I don't know that they witnessed it happen, but they saw the dead bodies of their brother and sister, which is terrible. And then on top of that, were put in their room and left there and not fed for days. So the fact that they are in foster care right now just breaks my heart, and really, and like, just, oh my, it just really pisses me off, because I can't understand why, if the mother's not arrested, they would not be with her, right? Maybe someone else out there can help me and explain to me why they believe they would possibly be in foster care, and what your opinions are on this mother. Next, I'm just going to go real quickly over what the mayor said, because this really bothered me too. It says, Lancaster Mayor R. Rex Harris described the murders as pretty brutal. Speaking with the Los Angeles Times, he said it seems an uptick in violent crimes and domestic abuse could be related to the stress of the pandemic. The social fabric of the country and the world has been shredded, and we are starting to see the aftermath, Harris told the newspaper. What I'm seeing is more and more people feeling desperate, and that can only have one result. That's asinine, if you ask me. It nothing that happened here in this family, in that home, could, in my opinion, directly be related to a pandemic. And that's what we're not going to do, is give people an out or an excuse for decapitating and stabbing their own children. Now, if you know, he were to have killed himself because he was stressed out, then maybe, you know, you could say it was the added stress from the pandemic and him not having as much money, or whatever the case may be. But there's nothing in the world that could, about a pandemic, that could or should make a parent brutally murder their own children. So I don't know what this mayor is talking about. So let's start to look into Lancaster like a little bit more. And a lot of people are also upset with a new, this mayor, like, I guess, like, put into place. There's also this new law where there's no enhancement charges on, basically, you know, like sentencing enhancements to include weapons and or weapon allegations. So because of that, this man, Maurice, could be looking at a lot less time than people are probably going to want him to be looking at. So I also found out that Lancaster is a charter city. And for those of you that don't know, a charter city is a city in which the governing system is defined by the city's own charter document rather than by general law. So I just found that really interesting. And if you guys want more information, maybe I can make a video about that. Or you guys can even just for yourselves look up more into charter cities and what they entail. I don't know what's going on in Lancaster. But what I do know is that this story is just not making sense to me. Everything, yeah, pretty much everything about it makes no sense. This man is, I mean, at this point, I mean, I'm going to say probably guilty, but maybe there's a reason that he's saying that he's not. And how did this mother allow not only one of her children to be stabbed to death, but another child to be stabbed to death, and two other children to be unfed for days? I mean, you can't use the battered, scared, you know, excuse over a course of that long with conditions that extreme. I'm sure that Maurice had to sleep at some point in the span of 5 days, right? So why didn't she do anything to help her children? Not only the ones that were killed, but the two remaining, to get them out of that house. I mean, I'm not saying that she was responsible, But what I'm saying is, I feel like there's a lot of questions that she needs to answer, because I don't trust the fact that she was completely unharmed when she left, when she walked out of that house and did nothing to help any of her children. I would be hanging on by, he would have had to kill me. Someone would have to kill me before they could get to my kid. And then if my kid was dead before I had a chance to know about it or whatever, if I'm not killing them, I'm damn sure going to make sure that they can't hurt any of my other children. I'm not going to walk out of the house without a scratch on me. And the condition of the children in the home being what they were, I'm not okay with it. So let me know what you guys think about this. I'm going to keep looking into it. I'm going to keep following his case and trying to get as many updates as I can into his court dates as they proceed. So, this is frustrating. This is so frustrating. But love you guys. Let me know what you guys think about this. Let me know what you think about the mom. Let me know what you think about Maurice. Let me know what you think happened, because I don't even know what to think at this point. Bye, everybody.